A very good evening to everyone. On behalf of the three of us, I would like to take this opportunity to thank and congratulate Aniket sir and Deep for curating this unique series of informal talks that engage with the younger generation of landscape architects in the country. As a group, it has given us an opportunity to really take some time to think about why we do what we do and how our minds work. Thoughts that had been pushed back in our minds and decisions that were taken subconsciously were given conscious thought and really to introspect and examine their meaning. So today the attempt is to tell a story that talks about our journey and through which I hope we all will have something interesting to take away. So Ajinkya, Nikhil and me decided to embark upon this journey to unite in the form of Bhagorama Landscape Architects in 2015. The name Bhagorama is a play on the word panorama and the connotation bag, which is the local term for a garden. By it, we meant to connect ourselves with all aspects of landscape, but we're also looking for an identity which common people can connect with, while understanding and celebrating the interconnectedness of it all.
There is a local saying in Pune, means Pune lacks in nothing. And it is definitely does not lack the presence of landscape architecture. As new branches in this dense and mature tree, that is Pune, the search for sunnier territories took us to new horizons. Places that were relatively unexplored but ready. Our diverse roots that stem from Kolhapur and Aurangabad became the catalyst for these. We decided to expand and consider opportunities to work outside Pune in towns like Aurangabad, Baramati, Kolhapur, Nagpur, Latur, etc. About half of the projects in our bag came from these loci. So moving away from the highly urban fabrics and transitioning into a much more open, a blanker fabric was really a good teacher. Because it allowed us to work on projects and scales that were closer to what we have learned academically. It was an exercise in exploring and experimenting with ecological techniques and mass planting to bring about a change in the microecology. And it was a chance to work with convenient beauty through simplicity, bringing out the best by being resourceful. There were landscapes that created around the common open spaces of new communities where we designed the framework of the spaces. The skeleton, which was the hardscape and the planting, would fill up over a period of time. There were landscapes which were about celebrating the rawness and traditionalism of the local architecture. And the landscape tried to echo that architectural languages, also incorporating the existing flora on the site, trying to retain the genius loci or the spirit of the place. These projects also took about a new phenomenon that is seemingly happening in the country, where landscape architecture is attracting an increased interest and awareness even in smaller centers. It points toward an acceptability of the need for designed outer spaces, a willingness to create the spaces that are more meaningful. This is a new typology of clients too, with an increased awareness in part because of the extent of social media, which has seemingly brought ideas of landscapes much closer. Meanwhile, in Pune, it was more about crafting urban structured landscape that were more about formality and minimalism. Like this rear garden, that was a new addition to a church. So, it was an interesting mix of design characteristics that unknowingly spoke about the genius loci. This brought up a few questions. For example, is there a certain typecast about the way they are supposed to look? Can urban gardens try to strike a balance of useful, functional spaces with the beauty of plant life and nature? How can we as designer open eyes and minds to the powerful impact of urban gardens that are talking about the untamed side of nature that are wild? How do we encourage the great proliferation of such landscapes within the cities?
So this really got us thinking about the importance of reaching more people with a view of creating understanding at their level about what value a landscape architect can bring. So we started writing about varied facets of landscape by engaging the users of the space directly through platforms like House and our blog. Starting off with topics as simple as attracting butterflies, bees and birds to the garden, it was an attempt to sensitize the minds towards the smaller joys of living, but also spoke from an ecological perspective. Gradually, the writings began to talk more about the intangibles and tangibles that directly impact the design experience. The effects of planting, lesser known plant families like grasses, demonstrating what they can bring to the garden, how to naturally incorporate sound in the garden. Through our travels, we also began to observe and record impressions that local gardens made. Eventually, the writings became about the plants themselves, talking about how there are plants for every kind of space and climate in India, the what and how of using them, using planting in a way that connects with people and commands attention. The result was twofold. The feedback from the readers was encouraging, to say the least, and we ended up becoming better acquainted with the strongest and trickiest material at our disposal, plants. Learning as much as we can about them, documenting them in a way that is relevant to our context, we have found is a tool that uncomplicates the planting design process to an extent, which in turn enables us to convey the design better to the clients. This was enlightening, also because it meant us doing a lot of research and reading, which ultimately informs our sense of purpose and enriches and exposes us to the wider spectrum of the profession. What this also did was try to minimize the divide, the unseen divide, between landscape architects and gardeners. So we tried to embrace it rather than to let it annoy us.
Talking about processes, as a group, we watch a lot of shows like Love Your Garden with Alan Titchmarsh and Monty Don's series of garden travels around the world. They are wonderful in how they talk about the layers of history, cultures, and how everything can be juxtaposed to create beauty and coherence. For Keki, reading about the poetics, history, and theory of landscape design are a fascinating way of expanding on knowledge. While Ajinkya excels in weaving these beautiful narratives that kind of takes the clients on an imaginary visualization of the landscape. So, the collective design process is a mix of all these things, plus ecological, local, and practical aspects, and combining all these things, shaking it up like a blender, and something comes out of that. With each of us complementing the others, bouncing ideas off each other, making work seem very little like work. As a team working cohesively, each member playing multiple roles, like designers, client relations, contractors, labors, publicists, and so on. Many a times we are reminded of anecdotes that Badesar shared during the lecture. On one such client interaction, we came face to face with a paradox. When the client confessed that the only people who actually interacted with the garden space were his watchmen, drivers and Mali. More recently, there has been a steady trickle of small projects in Pune itself, but which we realize are small only spatially, requiring the same or sometimes even more amount of thoughts that projects of greater scale would. People today are looking for moments of ordinary joy, such as coming home to beautiful garden and being able to sit somewhere peaceful and converse with neighbors and family. We are looking for that relief from always being inside and the ability to move outside, to appropriate the outside in whatever way possible. Evocative landscapes that are capable of bringing about lifestyle changes. And from this arises a need to design these really tiny urban gardens. These are spaces where children can play safely and celebrate birthdays. These are spaces of relaxation and family congregations, places to grow food and even spaces for working from home. The challenges they pose to us as designers are of different nature of varying levels, because sometimes we can handle large projects with relative ease, but large quantum of small projects is a different challenge. But their potential is great and one that needs to be explored.
In retrospect, we have come a long way in the 5 years or so since we started out. Some projects looked at landscape as art, some as forms of leisure, and some brought about changes in lifestyle. At the core of the process lies a deep sense of ownership, treating every project with individuality. Lot of simultaneous thoughts collide with each other, some through discussions, some through sketches, and some alluding to references. The design reaches that first level when it clicks, and clicks first and foremost in our minds. What we found is that there is no sort of formula when it comes to designing. It's all fairly intuitive, and that is what is best about being in this field. The intent or purpose at the abstract level remains the same, and that is design as a means of creative outlet, of self-satisfaction and happiness, of enriching, of creating beauty by enriching lives. Slowly and surely, navigating through them, we look forward to many more meaningful projects and are prepared to go wherever the journey takes us.